So when we get into talking about pleural effusions, that fluid that's accumulating in the actual pleural space is either a transudate or an exudate. And that can be a really confusing idea to try to wrap your head around. So let's write this just over here in the corner. So we're either talking about transudate fluid or exudate fluid. And the real difference between the two is how that fluid came about to be in that space. So how did that fluid get in that space, in other words? And there are a couple of common causes. For instance, if somebody has congestive heart failure, liver failure, if somebody had pneumonia, lupus, and how we really break those up is based off of two things. So our transudate and our exudate is gonna help differentiate how these things happened. Now, normally when we're talking about an exudate, it's something that was inflammatory. And so that would be like our pneumonia. Whereas something that was transudate, it's something that's changed the hydrostatic, static pressure. So something that's changed the pressure in the vessels, or something that has actually caused inflammation in the vessels. And so that's how we differentiate those two. So let's start with this image here. What we're looking at here is an image of a normal vessel. So you'll see that this is our vessel wall, right? And then we have our endothelial cells, which are these guys poking out here. And then these little yellow dots, these represent my protein. So my plasma protein. And then that blue fuzz, that's gonna be our actual fluid. So in a normal vessel, this is normal. Everything is pretty much even. It's equal. We don't have any fluid that's leaking out of the vessels. We don't have anything that's coming in that shouldn't be. This is our normal representation. So now if we actually come down here, and we're gonna come right below, let's look at something that would not be normal. So let's look at this second image that I have here. Now what we're looking at, this is gonna represent my transudate leakage. Now, in our transudate leakage, what happens? What you'll notice that we have less of these plasma proteins than we did in our normal scenario. So as a result, having less plasma protein, so let's put less protein, is gonna cause the fluid to actually shift out. So let me just change my color so we can see that we're talking about fluid. So it's gonna cause the fluid to actually shift out in between my endothelial cells outside of the actual vessel. So I'm gonna have a fluid shift out. Now you'll see that the endothelial cells in the vessel, this hasn't changed. My vessel looks the same, the endothelial cells are still sitting next to each other. They had the same interendothelial spaces as they did. The only thing that's different about this is that my protein is down. And that's gonna cause the fluid to shift out. Another way we can have a transudate leak is by, let's say, congestive heart failure. You heard me talk about that earlier. So here's our heart, right? So here we're gonna draw our heart, and I know it's a Valentine's heart, but just so we have an idea. And we know that in our heart, we have four chambers, right? So we have our right atrium, we have our right ventricle, we have our left atrium, and our left ventricle. Now let's say that this person had left-sided heart failure. So we've got heart failure on the left side. That's our congestive heart failure. So what's gonna happen? Well, we know that with that failure on the left side, we're gonna have increased pressure on the left side of the heart. And we know that the left side of the heart will back up to our lungs. So here's our lungs. Now, if the pressure is increased, that means that it's backing up towards our lungs and the vessels in our lungs, it's gonna cause an increase in pressure. And that would be the increase in our hydrostatic pressure that causes transudate. And as a result, the same idea here, that fluid that we have going on here, that fluid is gonna be forced out in between the endothelial cells because the pressure is so high. And so that fluid leaking out is going to leak into the actual pleural space. And that's what we talk about in a pleural effusion. Now what you'll see is that the proteins aren't leaking out. And that's because they're too big to fit in between these endothelial cells. However, with enough pressure, fluid can be squeezed out of there. And that leakage, again, is what we call our transudate. Now, our third scenario would be this, our exudate. So if we're talking about exudate fluid. Now, how does that happen? So first thing you should notice is that this vessel looks a lot bigger than the rest, and it is, it's much bigger. So I'm gonna go ahead and write exudate next to this one. Now you can see that this vessel is larger than the rest, and remember, what did we say was the big thing with exudate? It's inflammatory. So what happens to our vessels in an inflammatory situation? Well, they're gonna dilate, right? They're gonna become bigger. We know that we're gonna have some stasis of the fluid and the proteins that are happening, but that are circulating within the vessel. And we know that in an inflammatory scenario, our endothelial cells, you see how they're much more spaced out? So that interendothelial space becomes larger. Well, a larger interendothelial space means that not only is fluid gonna come out, but what else? What else is gonna come out of there? And if you're saying protein, you'd be absolutely right. So protein is gonna come out as well. So in an exudate pleural effusion, we have a mix of both fluid and protein in the effusion. So let's write that over here so we have it down. So we're gonna have both fluid, so just serous fluid, and protein in the exudate fluid. Whereas in our transudate, we're just looking at fluid because nothing else can fit through. Now, how do we test for this? When someone has a pleural effusion, of course we do a thoracentesis, and that means that we go in with the needle, we aspirate the fluid out of the space, out of that pleural space, and we're gonna test it. And that testing is called Lyte's criteria. So I'm gonna go ahead over here and I'm gonna draw a light bulb. So here's my light bulb. Let's put a little bottom on my light bulb. And that's called Lyte's criteria. So you can remember how we do that. And what they're looking for in the fluid is they're gonna look for the presence of protein. They're gonna look for a presence of cholesterol, of triglycerides. And if they see those things, protein, triglycerides, basically if they're seeing large solutes, large particles rather, then they know it was exudative. But when they test it and there's a low amount of protein or a low presence of these solutes or particles that otherwise wouldn't fit in these tiny spaces, then they know it's a transudate. And that's how we can tell what type of fluid is present in the pleural space and what was the cause of that. And quite honestly, because we know in a transudate scenario that protein is not leaking out of these spaces, they may not see any protein at all. And that's just gonna further confirm that it's transudate. So think about these things that we discussed. Transudate, we're talking about the hydrostatic pressure. So that would mean that CHF, that would mean our liver failure, those things change the pressure. Even someone that has that's in kidney failure. So because they're in kidney failure, we know that they have low protein, and low protein can cause these leaky vessels to occur. And then inflammatory, we mentioned that before, inflammatory, think about things that cause an inflammatory response in the body. So we're talking about the lungs, definitely pneumonia, that's a big one. We talked about lupus, I use that as an example. That's an inflammatory process as well. So when you see these terms, think about what's happening, right? Think about what the cause is, and think about what's happening at the level of the vessels.